You're watching LMCC.
Welcome to Westonka Memories. My name is Pam Myers, and I volunteer with the Westonka History Museum. Today I'm interviewing Jen Olson, a resident in Minnetrista. Welcome, Jen.
Thank you.
Nice to have you here today. So we're doing a series of Westonka memory interviews for our local residents. Tell me a little about your family history.
Well, my mother and father were from northern Minnesota. My mother was from Lincoln, and my dad was from Randall, right just close to Fort Ripley. And they met when my mother came to teach in the country school at Randall. She had been at Lincoln before, and when they married, my parents, I think they were. Dad was farming the family farm up there, and he had several sisters, and he had the sense that this wasn't going to work out the way that they might imagine, and thought that we'd be better off. I think I was maybe a little bit more than a gleam in their eye at that point. And so they set out and moved down to the Twin Cities. And he worked as a hired man at a couple of farms, and they were able to buy through the Federal Land Bank a home in Brooklyn Center. It's right south of 694 where the park and ride is now located. And when Dayton's bought land out in Brooklyn Center for Brookdale, things started to boom. We had 30 acres there and farmed there. And all of a sudden the taxes went from $89 to over, almost $3,000. And we were fortunate to be able to sell, but kept the house and two lots because mother was teaching. What had happened was that she had decided to go back into teaching when she visited the local school and wasn't really pleased with what she saw. And a mile hike up the road with kids that were sometimes, you know, I was an only child, and so you can be easily picked on. And that did happen. And so she was interviewed and got a teaching job at New Hope School, which is it's where the Robbinsdale Administration Building now stands, and with the understanding that she could take me with her. And so I had my mother for my first grade, at least. I actually ended up doing first and second grade in 1 year, and the county superintendent had me skip a year. But anyway, then she became kind of the principal of that two-room school. And she said, rather than take any money for that, she asked that I could continue on in Robbinsdale, which I did from grade 5 through 8. Mm-hmm. And that's where I say I'm probably the first open enrolled student, because for high school I went to Minnehaha Academy, which is the school in the Covenant denomination, which my father grew up in.
So how did it happen that you got to Minnetrista?
Well, that development, when the Daytons landed, and they bought, a developer came along and bought the 28 acres of land. I was at Wheaton College in Illinois my freshman year, and I got a telephone call from them and say, we'll get a railroad ticket. If you'll come home, we'd like you to see this property that was in the newspaper. Mm. And it was winter. And so we came out and we hiked that quarter of a mile driveway in the winter through snow. And when we came back and looked at there was buildings all over. They were wrecked. Nobody was living there. It really was not a pretty sight. And I thought, what in the world is this? Well, then we got up and walked up the hill and overlooking Saunders Lake. And I said, oh. that changed everything.
I bet it did.
The money that we got from the land in Brooklyn Center actually bought 88 acres out here. And we built, I designed in college the house, and my dad built it, and with my help too. And that money covered it. My dad was one that didn't want to go into debt. He had paid off his mortgage really fast over there when they moved into Brooklyn Center, where they had just a few dollars in their pocket and 1,000 chickens. So anyway, that's how we ended up moving out here. Mm-hmm. And when we started building the house, we got wind of the fact that some people had from the neighboring community had purchased what is now the North Saunders Lake addition. It was on the Saunders Lake is unmeandered, which means the boundary hasn't been established. And so you really owned the part of the 88 acres was underwater. We had not quite half of the lake on our property. And they had bought it because their town needed to put in a sewer system. And they felt the cheapest way to do it was to pump the raw sewage into Saunders Lake for their settling pond.
Oh my goodness.
That's everybody's reaction when I share that, because not many people know that story. And my dad talked to his attorney, and they went to the town board, because the municipal board had just been created at the state level to handle transactions for annexation and for incorporation. And they were going to annex that whole area into Mound. Mm-hmm. I'll say the name.
Sure.
So the town board agreed to apply for incorporation, which means you could bring it to the vote of the people, and they could decide whether they wanted to be incorporated into a village or now a city. Rather than where your boundaries are secured then. Mm-hmm. In a township, that annexation process was kind of the way the cities have grown over time. My dad went down to the hearing, and he was in an elevator with a group of people he didn't know and they didn't know him, but one of them was the current mayor at that time. And he said to somebody else, he said, "Well, it's too bad about those folks that are building a house out there, but when we're through, it won't be worth a nickel."
Oh my goodness.
And my dad came home just sick. And interestingly enough, the municipal board decision came down, and they let us go to Minnetrista go for the election to see if they wanted to incorporate. That's what got me started in politics. I worked with others, and we got out the vote, and there was a 95% turnout in that election, and it overwhelmingly voted for incorporation. So I always say, if it hadn't been for our family and my dad, that property would have been in Mound. Mm-hmm. And you know, I don't know whether they would have ever been able to pump raw sewage in there, but nonetheless, it would have been that land, and that. And then from then on, we elected a city council. The council at that point had an acre lot all over the city.
Huh. And so was it requirement, required minimum?
What's that?
Was a requirement, an acre lot?
Well, they zoned it. I don't know what it as a township. I guess there was really nothing. And so they had established the acre lot minimum. And one of the first developments that they approved was up in Rolling Hills. And there are clay hills up there, and acre lots couldn't support a septic system. So there was sewage running in the streets up there.
Oh,
and they still have to pump tanks constantly on that. And some of us got together and said, you know, that's not what we had in mind for Minnetrista. It's a beautiful area. And so we started, we didn't run for office, but we interviewed those who did and got some people on that really wanted to take a planful approach to the Minnetrista. And as I say, the rest is history. But it took a couple elections, and that came about. And Bob Hubbard was the mayor. He was an executive with Cargill, and he called me one day and said, "Would you consider filling out a term on the park commission?" And I thought, well, I suppose. I hadn't even thought about anything like that, which I did. Well, then it was a year and a half or so later, when that term was up, they asked me if I'd go on the planning commission. And I said, okay. And so I was on that for 6 years, chaired it for three, while we did the original comprehensive plan that was done then. And then I ran for city council. Mm-hmm. There was an opening there. And so I was on the council when the council had to act on the comprehensive plan. Mm-hmm. And after 2 years, the mayor wasn't going to run again. And it was usually the men on there that would on the council that would run. No one wanted to run. They said, "Jen, you run." So I ran unopposed. And that was when we had to get it through Met Council. Mm-hmm. So I kind of shepherded the comprehensive plan, and the basic elements of that are still in place today. Super. Of recognizing the develop area, a rural use with 10 acre minimum for agriculture, but then the ag preserve on the western half of the. So that was that I've had a long-standing involvement with
you certainly have.
With it. So
that's fun to hear how you got involved in politics.
Yes, yeah. When people would ask me, how did you happen to get involved in politics? And I said, it was sewage that got me involved in politics.
I guess it's true.
Yes.
So tell me about your input in designing the house. Is this a picture of the house that you have?
Well, I've got a picture that I happened to run across. I didn't even, it was an aerial view, and that has, that's the house right here. But this shows the whole farmstead, so the old barn and the silos, and there was another old barn that stood down here. I think we moved that one up here, and it was kind of a flat roof barn in this here, and there was buildings all over. There was chicken house here, there was chicken house there.
So did you do some of the new buildings? Did your family do some of these buildings new, or were
the house was the only one that we, Dad said, well, there was an old house that was up there, and he said, should we remodel that? And it wasn't in a very good position. And I said, I think we should do it new. And that's when I took on in my senior year at the university, I took a course in home planning and furnishing, and I designed the house there, and we ended up building that.
Terrific.
So, yeah.
So did your family continue to farm when they first moved there?
Yes, I've lived on a farm all my life. We've farmed in Brooklyn Center. We've farmed out here. Policy of green acres and agricultural preserve was put in place to assure that as values grew up, that it didn't keep people from continuing to farm. And so we've had, our farm has been on green acres since before the law was passed.
And what did you farm? We
had a menagerie of our cropland, was whether it was hay or corn. Usually, we never raised soybeans, but with corn and hay. And we had some dairy cattle to start with, but Dad, we saw that you had to upgrade to do any dairy, so we phased out of that. Had some beef cattle and sheep and goats, and we've had ducks and geese and chickens, and we had the whole menagerie, which was it was a nice lifestyle and we enjoyed that very much. And then, the other thing that was on this place that I've still, the Historical Society, I hope will take an interest in, but and it's going to be preserved, is a creamery. This land had been owned by Alfred and Agnes Jackson. And Alfred Jackson really was from Minnetonka Beach, and he had a liquor store that's up there by where the loose line comes across on 19. Mm-hmm. And so they had never lived there. They had always been rented. And they'd had all kinds of endeavors. They had they had hauled garbage in and fed pigs. They had a whole area that was pigs, at which wonderful for the where we had our garden, and same with the chicken houses. And but they had actually bottled milk. There was there's still some bottle caps around that from theirs, and the some of the containers. I don't think I found one of their glass bottles that was with their name on it. But the creamery has a walk-in cooler and a big boiler and a tank for and an old Myers pump and well that is now has not been in use. But every room had a drain in it. And we actually cleaned it up and lived in it for the year or two while we were building the house. And so I think that it has some potential, and others have come there and they said, oh, that's the cutest building, you've got to save it. And so I think I'll have some help right now the land has been in process of being developed around that in that area. Yeah. That will be happening over the next few years. And we worked it out so that I can stay in that house rather than have it be torn down. I will have an acre plus, and which will include the creamery. So preserve that, and I'd kind of like to keep reinvesting and restoring that a bit. Not for bottling milk, but it has some interesting possibilities. I think from an historical perspective, I wish I knew more about. And if there are people in the community that have had some background. Agnes Jackson died just a few years ago. I had no idea she was still living. Really? And I don't know whether she was what her emotional or mental state was, so whether I could have learned any more. But I regret that I didn't pursue that.
Were they of an age they would have gone to high school here?
I have no idea. I have no idea. And I haven't had time, and through my life I've been so busy. Sure. Between caregiving for my parents and winding down. My dad died in 1990 and my mother in 1992. Mm-hmm. And both of those years I was up for re-election, so mm-hmm. For the Senate. It was when I was mayor that I was approached to run for the Senate, which mm-hmm. I had never aspired to do either. Mm-hmm. As I said, I've often said that at Minnehaha, the only class I got a C in was civics and government, and I just hated it.
Oh my goodness!
And as I said, anybody would have told me that I'd spend so much of my life in government, I would have told them you're crazy. But that wasn't the Lord had other plans, I guess, for my life.
I guess so. What lessons would you say that your work life has taught you? You think of your work life in the legislature.
There's lots of lessons. I was an only child, and never married, so I don't have family, mm-hmm. and so I grew up really fairly independent, mm-hmm. and our family, my neighbors people that know us, we were a kind of a team. That my mother was a teacher, my dad mm-hmm. could do all kinds of things. And he saved things. We could always find something that would work for this or that. It was the old style,
sure.
Not just throw away and buy new of everything. Mm-hmm. It was, those were things that I felt like I learned so much from my father, mm-hmm. and I learned so much from my mother, but they were different, different qualities. And that my mother inspired me in terms of the teaching part. And that's why I went on into education, mm-hmm. Even though I loved math, and I was the only girl at the academy that took all the math there was to take, and then won the top award for math. So my teacher there was disappointed that I hadn't gone on in math, but it was my 4-H years that I think had a great deal of influence on me of applied learning, mm-hmm. and the other thing that I really enjoy, I'm not, even though now since my folks have died, I've been, living alone, but I'm not a recluse. Mm-hmm. I love working with people, and mm-hmm. and I felt that when I did run for the election that I was there to serve people. Mm-hmm. So I didn't run with a particular agenda. I ran to be able to help people navigate their dealings with state government. Mm-hmm. And most of the things that I, projects and even legislation that I did work on came from people that were concerned about an issue, and we worked things through. Mm-hmm. And I think those are, and the other thing was that I was 28 years in the minority in the mm-hmm. Senate, and only 2 years in the majority. But I got a lot of things done in the minority. And it's because you look at where people, if you're working on something that you believe is in the best interest of the state and the people, you try to find the way that will connect with others and sell that idea and try to keep it from being, many issues don't need to be partisan.
For sure.
And that was an interesting challenge, and I have, I could go on and on with stories of mm-hmm. how some of those things came about, but I won't do that because we haven't got enough time.
What did you like most about your job, and what did you not like?
Well, I like most the people and going to community events. Mm-hmm. I loved going to all the pork chop dinners and pancake breakfasts, and whether it was the fire department or the fish fries or all of those kinds of things, and because you connected with people.
Absolutely.
And as well as were supportive, and so I really enjoyed that kind of thing. And I got to the point where I enjoyed door knocking, going door to door. That was amazing to me because I still have people that would come up and say, "You knocked on my door." Huh? And I asked them where they lived. And in some cases, it probably was the first election that I ran in back in 1982, and they still remembered that I had knocked on their door. I mean, it's making connection with people.
Yes.
It's a people business. Mm-hmm. And I learned a lot from that, and I have very fond memories of those kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. Was there anything about it you didn't like?
Yes, I didn't. I really didn't like the party politics part of it. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things that go on. You can see some of it going on in the things that are happening today.
I suppose.
That it's a polarization, and mm-hmm. whether it's a lockstep or trying to distinguish and pull people apart rather than necessarily pull people together. Mm-hmm. And so I was greatly relieved when I felt that I hadn't taken any pledge of term limits, and it's hard for me to believe that I was there for 30 years. Mm-hmm. But when that time came, 2 years before the last year term was for 2 years, and I said, well, I will run for the 2 years because in the census goes in and then they redraw the lines. But I said, then I'm not running again. And they said, then we got in the majority for that last 2 years. They said, you didn't change your mind? I said, no. Mm-hmm. I just felt like I was released from that calling. Sure. And it was a great time to get out.
Perfect. Perfect. Were there people in the community or people that you worked with who were particularly influential for you?
Within the community, I would have to say that some of the people that worked together, Biz Reed, one of the former mayors, and Bob Hubbard was a mayor also. I appreciated the approach they took, and they were ones that definitely were influential in my becoming involved at the elected office, mm-hmm. appointed and elected office level, because as I said, I never aspired to do any of that.
Yes, it's very interesting, isn't it? So we're at the end of my questions. I always ask folk, how would you like to be remembered?
Well, the other night, it was an interesting thing. When I was a mayor, Metropolitan Council decided to cite landfill sites, and they cited three in Minnetrista, and they were out in that beautiful ag farmland. that out by 92 and 110 in that area. Two of them were for solid waste, and one of them was for sludge ash from the sewer plant. And I said, you know, they were having a public hearing over in Waconia, and I decided, well, I'm not going to go over there. You know, usually when you get to public hearing, we don't like the smell, the traffic, all of these things. It's kind of a not in my backyard thing. And I decided to prepare my testimony based on their criteria for selecting them. And so I went through that criteria, and one by one showed why they didn't fit their criteria. And they took all three of them out. And so there has been no landfill siting. I feel bad for, in the legislature, we finally got rid of the landfill siting process. It took a few years because it was devastating to a lot of people. But interestingly enough, in my last term, I've got a picture along that I'll share with a group of soil scientists came into my office and said, you know, the University of Minnesota is celebrating their 100th year of their soil science department. And our organization of soil scientists has had their 40th anniversary. And the Smithsonian Institute is coming to Minnesota to the Bell Museum with their Dig It exhibit, which has a column of soil from each state of the Union. And they say the Lester soil is the one that they have for Minnesota. And Lester soil is a unique soil. There's about 600,000 or maybe more through the middle of the state, going down a little bit as in Iowa, but it's mostly southern Minnesota. It ends up here in Minnetrista and Independence. And so our western, that farmland over there, Gale Woods Farm, has Lester soils. And I sat there when they were listening to that, and I said, you know, I don't know why you came to see me, but you would never have known that in 4-H they started a soil judging contest, and they were encouraging us to get in there, and they said, well, girls can participate too. So I did, and you know, and he said, all you have to do is listen to the instructions, and I did, and I came up with the top score. So I understood this whole soil judging thing. And so I said, yes, I will do that. And we did get it, even though I got criticized that having the most frivolous bill that we were going to name a state dirt. And but I had fun with that. And one of my colleagues on the Senate floor, when I used that, told about that, he said, you mean we're going to have to stop treating our soil like dirt? That's the soils that we have in western Hennepin County. And we've had ag preserve there. If you haven't been out to the Gale Woods Farm, they have a column. They have sliced one, and they have a display that an Eagle Scout made for it on the Lester soils. And so that is, I thought the beginning, keeping it out of landfills when I was mayor, and then being able to call attention and help people understand that we have some of the best ag soils that are important to agriculture, which is a strong foundation of our economy in this state. We should continue to respect it and preserve it if we can.
Perfect. Well, I want to thank you for sharing some of your family history with us today. We have history videos online accessible from our website, and we are getting many hits, and so people will really enjoy hearing our conversation. Thank you, Jen.
You're very welcome. Thank you for asking me.